Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Okay, part two. The refutation of the methodology of the Wahhabis. Right, so we've all heard many times the claim that I take that which is closest to the Quran and Sunnah from the four imams. Well, there are a number of points here that I can make to refute your strange methodology that you ascribe to the Salaf or Salihin, which is actually not their methodology, because none of them did this. That's already been proven. But anyway, one of those points that I could make here is this. You've got the fact that each of the imams had different usool. Usool al-fiqh and usool al-hadeeth as well were different. So you might say, well, you know, I'm going to take such and such ruling from Imam Abu Haneefah on this issue of Salat, and I'm going to take this other ruling of Imam Maalik on this issue of Saum, fasting. You've got a problem here. You see, because some of these rulings that you take, because they're built on different usool, the usool of the rulings that you take contravene each other. For example, the ruling you may have taken from Imam Abu Haneefah on Salat may be based on Hadith Ahad. And the problem here is the ruling that you take from Imam Malik may be based on the actions of the people of Medina, which is built on Imam Malik's statement, I prefer the actions of 1,000 than the statements of a few. So Imam Malik preferred not to act upon Hadith Ahad when he found that the actions of the direct descendants of the Sahaba in Medina contravened this Hadith Ahad. And his reason given is because I cannot imagine that these people would contravene the Sunnah. Okay, so you've taken one ruling from Abu Hanifa and one ruling from Imam Malik, and the usul of these rulings contravene each other. So what exactly is your usul al-fiqh? Can you explain? How did you reach this verdict that so-and-so's, for example, Abu Hanifa's ruling is closest to Quran and Sunnah on this issue, and Malik's ruling on this other issue is closest to Quran and Sunnah? What's your usul, exactly, to reach this decision? Because I think you're just following your nafs, and I'll prove it. I'll prove it. You don't have usul al-fiqh on this kind of issue like this. You can't possibly have, because this principle that you use here is, well, only this one imam said such and such, and the other three say this, so we'll go with the other three, the majority. No, first problem with that claim is that's only the majority out of the three imams. Next, you've got to consider the followers of the imams, their direct students. Alright, let's have a look at how many students Malik had, and how many students Abu Haneefah had, and how many students ash-Shaafi had, and how many students Ahmad ibn Hanbal had. Count their students, number them, name them, and then add the figures, add them up. Now, it stands to reason that for many centuries, and still up until this day, Abu Haneefah has the majority of followers out of the whole Ummah. Around 80% of the Ummah follow Imam Abu Haneefah in fiqh, at least. Forget their aqeedah for now. Maybe some of them are upon baatil aqeedah. I'm not going to dispute this right now. But in fiqhi issues, 80% roughly follow the madhab of Abu Haneefah, or at least they claim to, and in for the most part of it they do. So where is the ijmaa? 80% of the ummah who follow one imam, or the other 20% who follow three? Where's the ijmaa? You're being very deceitful when you say the three imams agree on this issue and the one imam stands alone on this issue, when the one imam alone has 80% of the ummah as his followers and pretty much always did have. And you're trying to present the imams themselves that the madhhab is named after as the way of trying to prove the ijmaa. Sorry, you lose. You have to count their followers and see what the ijmaa is. Yeah? Do you get the point now? If you want to go by the hadith that says my ummah will never convene on baatil, then you have to go by the number of the followers these imams have as well. So you lose. Again, sorry, but you lose. You always lose. And why do you always lose? Because you are the people of Dalala. You are the people of Baatil. You follow the sunnah of the Yahud, who say we are saved because of our title of being Banu Israel, our bloodline. And that's it. It's as simple as that. You've got a similar mentality. You think you're saved by a title. You're not. You're on Baatil. Simple. Accept it. Move on to the Haqq. Now, another point here, which we're going to have to present on part 3, because we're reaching the time limit again for the video. I'll make this next point in the next video, inshallah ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Prepare for another battering.